website right now, but we're going to iron those out. And we just thank God for everybody that has taken the time to come and worship us today. Amen. Worship with us and the Lord on today. We just give God all the glory, honor, and praise. Because we know with God, everything is possible, right? We know God is in the business of blessing his people, and we just thank him for being who he is in our lives. Right. We're going to get into our worship service this morning, but we also have to remember that this is the Advent season. We got a lot of stuff going on out here in the world, a lot of things that are causing us to lose our focus and lose our mindsets on who God is in our lives because of what's happening all around this globe. But we still have to remember that this is the season for Jesus, who is going to come and be born on this particular portion of the season, right? And it's going to let us know that even with all of the stuff that's going on, Jesus is still the reason for the season, right? Amen. Amen. Well, we're going to go into our worship service. So if you stand on your feet, I got a song right here that prayerfully y'all will be ready to get into and sing and just let your body go free today and let God have his way. Amen. How many of y'all know the blood still works? Oh, come on now.
Come on now.
Come on, somebody else got to tell me. How many of y'all know the blood still works?
Yeah.
Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for his words, the music. And we just want to go into our scripture reading this morning.
Yeah.
Our scripture reading is going to be coming from, the book of Romans.
All right.
Hallelujah. From the book of Romans. We're going to be talking about a few things here this morning from the book of Romans. The Bible says in verse 1, therefore being justified by faith. How many of y'all have faith?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Everybody's howling and screaming about that. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. And through him, we also have access by faith into this grace in which we stand. We're all standing right in the midst of grace right now. Amen. And we rejoice, hallelujah, on the hope. Somebody say on the hope. On the hope of the glory of God. Oh, Lord, my Lord, yes, Lord. And then we go to verse 3 and it says, and not only this, but we glory in affliction also, knowing that afflictions work out patience, and patience works out experience, and experience works out hope. And then verse 5 says, and hope, somebody say, and hope, does not make us ashamed, because the love of God has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given unto us. Amen. And his word is blessed. Y'all may have your seats. Praise be to God. You may have your seats. Oh, Father God, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father God, we just thank you right now, Lord. We thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for giving us this opportunity to come to you, Lord. Giving us this day our daily bread. Forgiving us for all of our trespasses. Forgiving us from everything that we have done or said against you or even against our name. Lord, we just thank you for delivering us from our sin. And as we go forward today, Lord, we just thank you for all of the blessings that you have given us, Lord, and all of the blessings that we are waiting upon for you to deliver unto your children. You have given us life and liberty. You have given us the victory in knowing that when we are connected with you, we will not fail. We know right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, that your Son has come and done the work that needed to be done on this earth so that we can partake and be partakers and be the ones who are benefiting from you. And as we go forward in the service today, Lord, we pray that those who are in the sanctuary today, Lord, and even those who may still be on their way, and those who are on Facebook Live, and those who are on the conference call line, may each and every one of us be able to receive what you have for us today, Lord. Maybe through word, maybe through prayer, maybe through music, whatever, maybe even through the communion service that we're going to have today, Lord. Let it be something that you will show up and show out with on our lives on the day, Lord. Because we are anxious, we are able, we are willing, we are just, we're anticipating you being great in our lives. So as you continue to take us to the next level, Father God, as you continue to show us the right way to go, as you continue to guide our path and let us know that we're heading down the right road, we pray right now in the name of Jesus that you will comfort us even in our times of trouble, that you will comfort us even in our times of indecision on whether or not we want to continue to serve you. Even in our times of situations in our family's lives, our work environment, whatever it is that we need some help with, Lord, we pray that you would help us right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. Give us what we need, Lord. Lift us up. Woo, hallelujah. Take us where we need to go, Father God. Oh, man, solidify the foundation that you have put us on, Lord, and maybe it gets a little shaky and a little rocky. But we know that even with you, Lord, your angels say that they will bear us up so that we won't stub our toe on the stone. So we're trusting in your promises that you've given us, God, that we can make it through this season of uncertainty, that we can make it through to the next level that you have for us, God, that we can be who you want us to be. Because you are all that you are to us. You are everything. You are magnificent. You're all powerful and you're almighty.
So we just love you right now in the name of Jesus. And as the word comes forth today as well, Lord, we pray that the word is going to come forth and it's going to bring some encouragement to those who need it. It's going to bring some clarification to those who need it. It's going to bring some help to those who are going through a process right now that they don't understand. We just know that your word is right and we know that you are great. So we just love you. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Send it to our
2329. And that's Cremora, Virginia, and the zip code is 24431. That's P.O. Box 329 in Cremora, Virginia, and the zip code is 24434. And we do have a new website that's up right now at this time, and if you have a prayer request that you would like to send to the new website is MorningStarBaptistChurch.net. It's MorningStarBaptistChurch.net. Go to the website, check it out, and see what's going on in there, and look at the look how the website is set up. And we're still taking some of the tweaks out of this online live feed that we have that we can do on our website. So just give us a little time. We're getting it. Slow but sure. You know, that's what I always say, slow but sure. But again, we want to thank God for everyone that is here today. I want to give a shout out to all the preachers and pastors and people who are proclaiming the name of Jesus Christ out there in our church community as well. Because we know Morningstar is not the only church that's doing live feed and all of the other things that's happening. There's other churches that are still in the mix and doing the same thing. And that's why it's so wonderful how God is blessing the church right now. God is giving the church an opportunity to go out into the earth and preach the gospel. And this is such a wonderful thing. We're not confined to the four corner walls that we stay in. But hey, we still have to take care of our flocks, y'all, too. So don't get it twisted. Don't think that all this internet stuff is cool, but we still have to take care of our people. So that's why I pray for each and every one of you pastors out there that are doing the work. And I ask that you continue to pray for me and our church here in Morningstar. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. And that's our announcement for today. I got another announcement coming, but we're going to have our meeting on tomorrow for our executive board meeting. Will be tomorrow evening, and it will be on our conference call line, and we'll be talking about some things, and I'll get back with the church after that, okay? God bless you guys. All right. How many of y'all know it's Advent time? It says waiting, expectation, and preparation for hope. Who's got hope in their heart this morning? Who's hoping for something?
I'm pretty good.
Amen. You got to be hoping for something in life. You can't just wake up in the morning and don't have any desire or don't have any urge to want something out of life. You got to have something that you want to do or something that you want in life. It may not be the right thing, but at least it's something that you're hoping for. Amen. There's a whole lot of folks out here wanting something that they don't really need. But praise be to God. Hope is a wonderful thing, and we're going to be talking about that a little bit this morning as we go into our service. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Because the Bible says where there is hope, you will find Jesus. Where there is hope, you will find Jesus. I've got a song that I want to play before we go into the message for this morning. And those of you who want to jump ahead and just take a sneak peek at the message, the Bible is going to be coming out of the book of Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 11. Chapter 29, verse 11. It's one verse this morning. Praise God. That's going to be our focus verse for today. And after this next song, I pray that you all be ready to hear what thus saith the Lord. Keep the prayers coming from the pew.
Hallelujah.
There you go. Praise be to God. Hallelujah. How many of y'all have been healed by the Lord at some point in time in your life?
Thank you.
Amen, amen.
How many of y'all have been broken and then healed by the Lord at some time in your life? See, there's a difference between being broken and healed in the spiritual realm and being healed in the physical realm. Because if you haven't been broken and then healed, you just keep on living. That's all I can tell you. And then, because then you know for sure, without a shadow of a doubt, that God is good. So let's listen to this song.
Into this building,
yeah.
What you have.
indescribable. You can't even put words to it at times. All you can just say is hallelujah, thank you, Jesus.
Yes.
Because, you know, everybody goes through different types of situations and different types of misery and different types of struggle and different types of things that can knock you down and knock you right off your feet. You know, everybody has a different time and place that they go through something. But the thing is, though, we all go through something. None of us are exempt, from the babies all the way up to the senior folk. None of us are exempt from having to go through something. So we just thank God for his grace and his mercy. Thank God for his grace and his mercy. Praise the Lord. I gave you the scripture that we were going to read today. It is simply coming out of the book of Jeremiah, chapter 29, verse 11. You can just sit back and relax for just a moment so I can read the scripture. And it says simply, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future." Ain't that all right? Now let's make it personal, y'all. When you make it personal, I read what the scripture says, but make it personal in your life. "I know," says, "for I know I have the plans for you, Rudy," put your name in it, declares the Lord, "plans to prosper you, my brother, and not to harm you. Plans to give you, soul brother number one, hope and a future." If you put your name, when you make it personal, oh my God, it gets even more powerful, because we can read all day long. We were talking about reading the Bible the other night, my wife and I, yeah, we can read the scripture, but when you make it personal, when you can attach that thing to your spiritual mindset, when you can attach it to whatever you're going through, oh man, it just grows wings. It just takes off and it goes to a whole other level. So that is our scripture reference for today. And the title of our scripture, the title of the message is simply, "Where there is hope, you will find Jesus."
All right.
Hallelujah. Let us pray. Father God, we just thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you again for this opportunity, because it's preacher time right now, Lord. You've given us a word to bring to the sheep today. You've given us a word even for the preacher that's preaching this thing today. But we know that, God, you are in the midst of what's going on in this whole congregation, in this whole service right now, Lord. And we pray that you will continue to take control and leave us where we need to be left, so that you can take over and do what you do best. As we go forward in this word, Lord, someone already said, there's power coming out of the pew. That means that there's power. And when there's prayer coming out of the pew, that means there's power coming from the pulpit. And when there's power coming from the pulpit, that means that it's coming from you. So we just thank you right now for the word that you're getting ready to deliver to the folks that need to hear what this word has to say. And as always, that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, so that I will not be ashamed of you and I will not put you to shame. We just thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 This is 2020, and usually, you know, whatever year has gone by, we get ready for the new year to come in, and we look back on the year that we've had, and there's always something that seems to jump out at us, right? And say, man, you know what, this year was like really special, or this year was crazy, or this year was whatever this year was. Well, I believe I got some witnesses in the house of this year. This 2020 year has been a real humdinger when it comes down to going back and doing the Monday morning quarterback mindset thing. There's stuff that we just didn't have control over in this year. We started out with plans. We started out with mindsets, things that we wanted to do in life. We started out even with loved ones that were with us. And now we're getting close to the end of this year, and If our plans are not worked out the way we wanted them to, we have loved ones that are not here anymore because of the situation that's happening in this earth with this viral war that we're under, this COVID war that we're dealing with, praise be to God. And even for a believer, it can put you in a mind in a place of hopelessness, right? Because you're looking at all the hopelessness in the world right now. On top of the bad news, we have our own circumstances that each and every one of us are dealing with, physical, financial, personal, whatever it may be that we're dealing with. And it can be overwhelming for those of us. Amen. It's easy to feel hopeless. But I got a question for you. How do we find hope for what seems hopeless? How do we find the hope that we're looking for that seems hopeless right now? Today I want to hopefully answer the question of what we need to do when we're going through this hopeless situation that we find ourselves in sometimes. There's just a couple of points here that I'm not going to stay on this word long, because Jeremiah already told us through the word of God that he has the plans already made for each and every one of us. So that ought to tell us right there that we need to seek who? We need to seek the Lord. Because his plans are better than our plans. And believe it or not, by March of this year, a whole lot of us that weren't seeking the Lord because we were seeking our own plans got smart and realized we need to go ahead and start seeking God a little bit more, because if we don't, we're going to be in trouble. But unfortunately, the trouble was already too great. We found ourselves with over 200,000 folks that have gone on to glory. Not because of what you and I individually didn't do. It was something that was above our pay grade, as we used to call it in the military. That we don't have the decision-making power to do. But now, we still have that thing, that place, that person, that entity that we can go to, and his name is Jesus. Because when we call upon the name of the Lord, oh my God, he will make things. Woo, so much better. Even though we got to go through, he will still be there for us. So the first thing that I looked at, the first thing is that hopeless situations are allowed by God. Don't worry, don't get it twisted. Don't think that God is not in the midst of all of this stuff. Because the Bible is filled with stories of hopeless situations. All you gotta do is go to one of the characters by the name of Noah. You can look at Moses, you can look at Gideon, you can look at David, you can look at these action figures in this book of the Bible and see that they had also had faced hopeless situations in their lives. Dealing with tragedy, dealing with crisis, dealing with people struggling. And then you jump into the New Testament, and you can even see that followers were even going through more stuff that caused hopeless mindsets. How do we know? Well, any of you all that have been with us in Bible study, you know we're studying the book of Acts. But in Acts chapter 14, verse 22, it says that they encouraged them to continue in the faith, reminding them that we must suffer many hardships to enter the kingdom of God. Experiencing hardships is just a part of the journey that you and I are on. Those of us who love the Lord and are called, we know that we've got to go through to get to. We are allowed by God to suffer, but it's a benefit because of the suffering that we go through. Oh, hopelessness. Hopeless situations allows you and me, hallelujah, to see God more clearly. Don't you know that when you're going through some stuff and you're shaking your head and looking in the mirror and wringing your hands and not wondering what in the world is going on, it lets you know that you can see God a little bit better. Oh, yeah. Be Because if, in Psalms chapter 18, verse 6, it says, but in my distress, it says, I call out to the Lord. And I said, yes, Lord, I'm praying to you for help. And the Lord heard me from his sanctuary. The Lord heard me from his high place. And said, I will cry to him and reach his ears and let him know, I hear you, baby. I got your back. Sometimes depression opens our eyes so that we can pursue and see more of God. Sometimes we just have to get to the end of our rope or to the edge of the road where we're getting ready to jump off that cliff in order for God to open our eyes and show us the things that we need to see and let us know that everything's going to be okay. It's easy to lose sight of God when you get caught up in all of the stuff that's happening out here in the world. But with everything, when all things are dark and gloomy, all the distractions of life are being removed from you, we can see God more clearly when that happens. It allows us to see the light shining through the dimness of the dark, letting us know that on the other side there's somebody by the name of Jesus waiting for me, waiting for us. Hopeless situations strengthen our faith and clarify our convictions in following Christ. The trials that we go through will show that our faith is definitely genuine. I don't know about you, but I've been trying today. There's been some faith-testing moments in my life. And I believe I can get an amen for some of us in here today. It is being tested that purifies us. It is being tested that knows that your faith is strong when you go through the trials that may come up against you. It will bring you so much praise, glory, and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to this whole world. Because you know, once he comes back to get us, you say, yes, Lord, I made it. I was there, faithfully, going through the situation that you had made me go through. And yes, it made me stronger. I may have lost some things. I may be without certain stuff right about now. But I know that you are my anchor and my rock. It is in hopeless situations of life that our faith is truly tested. The question is, will we cling to what God is saying, or will we continue to follow what the world is trying to shovel into our mouths? I'm here to tell you, where there is no tangible evidence of God's goodness, that's what the world is talking about. The world can't offer us his loving care. The world can't offer us his provision. The world can't offer us the protection. The world can't offer us nothing but hopelessness. And when these things happen, when we find ourselves submitting to the world's mindset, we must remember that we are in God's hands. We can't get it twisted. We can't get it confused. Because while we're in God's hands, he is the molder, and we are what? The clay. He can mold us. He can make us stronger. He can make us more useful for the kingdom building process. And then after he molds us and shapes us, he puts us in that fire so that all of the impurities can be burnt off of us. So that when we'll come out like pure gold. Oh, I don't know about you. I can't wait for him to finish taking me through this fire that I'm going through. Because the pure gold that we're talking about is when he comes back and takes us home to glory. The strength of our faith and the clarity of our convictions to serve him lets us know that hopelessness is not part of our DNA. Woo, Lord. Hope results from clinging to God despite the hopelessness of the situation that we live in. How do we know that? Go to the Word. Go to Job. Chapter 13, verse 15. Where Job simply says, though they slay me, yet I have hope in him. That's powerful. That's powerful for a man. If y'all ever read the story, that lost everything. Everything he acquired from the time that he was a youngster. Building up his wealth. Building up his family. Building up all his possessions and everything he thought that was important in his life. To have it snatched away from him. And not only that, his body was attacked with sores and boils, and his skin was coming off of his body. He was racked with pain on a daily level. And he was still able to say, though they slay me, I will trust in you. The hope of nothing less. Even his wife came up against him. And that ought to tell us something right there. When your spouse, or your siblings, or your best friends, or whoever it is that comes up against you when you're serving the Lord, telling you what you're doing is crazy and not real, you need to let them know that they need to go and get their pulse checked. Because they're in the wrong place at the wrong time.
Amen.
The second thing I look at is hopelessness. Hopeless situations remind us of our ultimate hope. The ultimate hope, I said earlier, lets us know that our ultimate hope is knowing that Jesus is the one who we are going to cling to. Hopeless situations have a way of stripping life down to the bare essentials. It's letting us know that we become much more keenly aware of the fading of this world's great treasures that tend to call us into what the world is talking about. Hopeless situations are not for us as believers. It's too easy to put our hope in things in this life. And I've been there, done that. And it's okay. I understand it. Because there's nothing wrong with personal goals and pursuits in life. But you got to put them in the right context. You got to put them in the right order. You can't put the cart before the horse. You know, you can't put stuff that you want to do before you put God in the front. You gotta put things in order. But many people tend to fall in love. Hallelujah. With their careers. Many people tend to fall in love with their money, possessions, positions that they have in their jobs, even in the church. People fall in love with these things instead of looking to Jesus and looking to God and finding out how, when, and where they're supposed to be going. So when we lose all of what the world offers, when the world, the enemy says, hey, it's time for me to pull the plug on you, and all this stuff that you gain, we are confronted with this mindset of hopelessness. And I'm gonna keep reiterating it. We are not in a hopeless stage because we are servers of the Lord Jesus Christ. Many people have lost hope because of the economy that's happening right now. Things are really jacked up. Amen. People are losing their job. People can't afford their rent. People can't do. There's just a lot going on. Amen. And thank God for those who have it like that. But the ones who are struggling, the ones who are dealing with all of the stuff that's happening right now, remember without a doubt that God is able. When you continue to trust in him, and I know it's hard, but when you continue to trust in him and don't relinquish your compassion for serving him, he's going to work things out.
Yes.
He's going to work it out.
Yes.
He's going to work it out.
Yes.
Hopeless situations can show us that we have our hope in the wrong places. But when we turn our hope to the one who is there waiting for us, we will be in good shape. Because this world is fading away, folks. And we are going to leave this earth. Because one of the best ways to protect yourself from the despair and hopelessness is not to fall in love, but with the world is trying to feed you. Why? Because this world, this life is a pit stop compared to the eternity that we're going to be with Jesus Christ. Because unless we maintain an eternal perspective regarding this life, we will fall into that thing called hopelessness. We are not in the land of the living, y'all. Y'all might want to write this down. We are not in the land of the living going to the land of dying. We are in the land of dying, traveling to the land of the living. And that's hope. That's hope. That's knowing that there's something on the other side that we have available for us. Hopeless situations remind us of our ultimate hope. Hopeless situations can still accomplish good. Because if you feel like you're going through something right now, if you feel like you're stuck in a rut, that you're in a place where you're there, that this doesn't seem like there's a light at the end of the tunnel. Remember 8:28 in the book of Romans, and it says that, and we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Well, then, God can and will use everything in his power to accomplish his good purpose in our lives. God is always looking for opportunities in hopeless situations. Look at the Bible. There's a story in the book of John where this man was born blind, for instance. And when the disciples asked Jesus, they said, why was this man born blind? Was it because of his own sins or his parents' sins? They're trying to put it on somebody before him, right? Well, Jesus had to fix him. He said, no. It's happened so that the power of God could be seen in him. So don't you think if you're going through something right now, I don't care what it is. If you're going through something right now, don't you know that it's going to be done in the power of God for your life? Because somebody needs to see the victory that you're going to be coming out in. Somebody needs to see this thing. They're going to be like, oh, man, I didn't know he or she was going through that kind of thing. But, dang, I didn't realize that God was going to bless him like that. Woo, man, what? Get out of here. That came from where? To who? Oh, my God. This is what it's talking about. Jesus is letting us know it doesn't matter what the world says. It doesn't matter what the world looks like. It doesn't matter what the world talks about. It doesn't matter what the world tries to do to you. God is still in control. And Jesus is always looking for opportunities to work out hopeless situations in our lives. Man's hopelessness is conditioned, just like this blind man's mindset was conditioned. Because this is where the kicker comes from. When you're talking about scripture, you got to be careful on how you apply scripture to your life. When you look at Romans 8:28, he's talking about a conditional promise, not an unconditional. A conditional promise means that you have to do something. You have to be available for this promise to work. You have to be in the right position for this promise to work. So this particular scripture, when it says all things work together for those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose, it's conditional because all things do not work together for those who don't know the Lord. This don't work for everybody, y'all. This only works for believers. This only works for blood-washed, saved, and sanctified believers. So don't let somebody tell you that, oh, yeah, you know the Lord saved. Yeah, but are you saved? Because if you're not saved, it ain't working for you, Doc. It's working for me because I know I'm saved. I know I'm saved, sister. I know I'm saved, mister. This is only true for those who love God and walk in obedience to his purpose in their lives. So what should be our response in this crucial and critical moment of following God? Well, we have to continue to love God. We have to continue to trust God. We have to continue to believe in God. Because God is good and his plans are set up for you and is set up for me so that we can prosper and it will not bring us any type of negative things in our lives. So, God is the God of brokenness. That's right. God is the God of despair. Amen. God is the God of who we trust in the midst of whatever it is that we're dealing with. And when we are going to that level, doing what we're supposed to do for the Lord, it unleashes the power of God in our lives. Oh, man. So that his blessings will shower down on us and take us to a whole nother level. And then my last point, and I'm out of here, it says, some hopeless situations in this life, God does not change. Woo! What do you do when God says no? What do you do when you're going through a situation and God says no? There was a guy by the name of Paul who had a thorn in his flesh. And if you want to read the story, it's 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7 through 9. He says, even though I received much, such wonderful revelation from God, so to keep me from becoming proud, I was given a thorn in my flesh. A messenger from Satan to torment me and keep me from becoming proud. So this is what I'm trying to convey right now, that God will bless you. God will be there for you. But sometimes God will say no so that you can know who he is in your life. Oh, my Lord. Oh, my God. Because Psalms 34:18 says, the Lord is close to the brokenhearted. He rescues those whose spirits are crushed. I've had my spirit crushed before, and I called upon the name of the Lord. And for a minute, God said, well, you still got to wait, son. I'm here for you, but you got to wait. So when God says no in your situation, he always says yes to you. He'll say no about your situation, because it may be a situation that you really don't need to be in. But he'll say, yes, my son, I got your back, but this isn't for you. He will always provide you with an increase of power and strength to endure the difficult things that may come upon you in life. And it's just a fact of life that God is not only going to remove all the hopeless circumstances in our life, he's just not going to do that, because this is what we deal with in these fleshly bodies. But it's not an indicator that God doesn't love us, folks. God still loves us. But we're living in a fallen and disappointing world. And God is not pleased with what the world is going to and what they're dealing with. But he still loves us. And he promises that he will be with us to the end of the earth. Sometimes God allows brokenness to continue so we can experience his closeness to us. When God is talking to us and he wants to get close to us, like he's doing right now, he wants to get close to everybody in this season of 2020. He wants us to understand that we have got to do some things in order to come back to him and be right. The first thing is humility, because God always acknowledges humility, letting him know that he is the one who's in charge. He wants us to surrender, because surrender is our response to God. Know that he is in charge, and we choose to surrender everything we have to him. Acceptance is our response also, to agree to walk with God through whatever situation we're in, whatever situation that may look hopeless on this side. We got to know that God has a better plan on the other side. We accept the situations, we accept the circumstances, and we keep it moving. And then the fourth thing is obedience. And obedience is a result of all the other three that I just talked about. We continue to walk in obedience with God through his word, regardless. So as we get ready to come down from here, I just want to just reiterate the fact that when we have hope, when we feel like we're losing it a little bit, he will pour his hope into us because we are seeking God. Where there is hope, you will find Jesus. It might be on the other side of that door that you're getting ready to walk through, knowing that on this side you've been going through hell day in and day out. But on the other side of that door, there's a thing called hope. And there's a person by the name of Jesus who died for our sins, who went to his grave, who rose on the third day and went to heaven with all power in his hand. It's that Jesus mindset that we have to go to in an opportunity to receive the hope that he has for each and every one of us. And as I leave here, I've got a quick prayer that I pulled up from Romans chapter 15, verse 13, coming from Paul. It simply says, I pray that God, the source of hope, will fill you completely with joy and peace because you trust in him. Then you will overflow with confident hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. God bless you. May the Lord keep you. May everybody just stay on your feet just for a moment. Stretch your legs. You've been sitting for a while. Just stretch your legs out. Those of you who are Facebook Live, stand up and stretch your legs. Pull your car over. Get out your car. Just get up and stretch your legs. Folks in the conference line, just stretch your legs for just a moment. Just take this moment just to think on the goodness of Jesus and what he has done for you. And your soul should cry out, hallelujah. Thank God for saving me. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and what he has done for me, my soul cries out, hallelujah. Thank God for saving me. Amen. Y'all may be seated. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. As we come to the end of this particular service, we want to thank God, and we just pray that anybody and everybody who is able to hear what the Word of God has to say was convinced or even pricked in some way to acknowledge that God is available for you, even through all the stuff that you may be going through. Amen. He is still in control. And those of you who don't know Jesus and the pardon of your sins today, this is an opportunity for you to come to him. This is the beginning of the beginning. It's not the beginning of the end. It's the beginning of the beginning, as we're getting ready to go to a new level in glory. So if you want to be a part of this kingdom process, if you want to be a part of this great nation of godliness, this is an opportunity, amen. You don't have to come with all your I's dotted and all your T's crossed. It doesn't work like that. You come just as you are. Bring all of your burdens. Bring all of your cares. Bring all of your concerns. Bring all of the junk in your trunk. Bring everything you got that has been holding you back, that has put you in a hopeless position, and bring it to Jesus. This is your opportunity. Plain and simple. And if you want to come to the Lord, the doors of the church are open. The doors of the church are open on our conference call line, on our website, on our Facebook Live, even here in the sanctuary with the members that are here today. The doors of the church are open, and you can come to Jesus. Come to Jesus now. And once you've given your life to the Lord, join a Bible-based church. I'm going to keep hammering that thing until God hammers me out of here. Join a Bible-based church. A church is going to teach the Word of God. A church is going to live by the Word of God. And a church that is going to come forth and be clean and unblemished so that we can be ready when Jesus comes. A church that's going to educate us, that's going to take us to the next level so that we can just be better servants. Amen. Let's just keep doing that. So if there's anybody in the house or anybody on Facebook Live or anybody on the conference call line, you know what to do. Just stand up and say, I want to be saved. I want to join a branch of Zion, Morningstar, a great church to join, because we're in a moving position. God is getting ready to escalate us to another place. So we just keep on going. So as we move forward, we have community service as well this afternoon in a few minutes. So I just wanted to give everybody time to think about it. Hallelujah. And if anybody on Facebook or anybody on conference call line, just shoot me a text message or whatever, and I'll be praying for you and everything that you need. I'll be there for you. Amen. Father God, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for your voices, Lord. We thank you for this message. We thank you for just being who you are in our lives. As we go forward into our communion service, Lord, we pray that those who are partaking in the communion service, Lord, are excited about it as I am. Because this is our final communion service for the year 2020. And we just know that you are still able to do everything exceedingly and abundantly more than ever we could ever ask or think. We just, in the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. 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 Amen.
All right. Let's have our offering. We do our offering right now. We'll bless the offering
as it comes forward. Praise be to God. And while we bless an offering, we need people getting ready for our communion service. Those of you who are at home, if you have a piece of bread or juice or whatever it is that you might want to use, you can use that at this time and be ready to receive what we're getting ready to do for our supper with the Lord. Amen. But right now, we bless the offering. Father God, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for the gift that you have given us, Lord. The gift is life. And as we go through life, Lord, we thank you for every blessing that you have given us that we can accumulate things in life. But right now, Lord, we want to give some of those things back to you. And one of the things that we want to give to you, Lord, is through our offering. Hallelujah, Jesus. Bless those who are able to give today, Lord. And we know that situations are causing people not to be able to give as well. But we just want to bless them too. And just let you know, God, that we love you, we adore you. And we're going to continue to be with you as you stay with us. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
And also, while we're on the sidebar waiting for to get ready for community here, I just want to put just a little shout out and let people know those who are going to be doing the donations for our upcoming Christmas family that we are adopted for Winona Elementary School. We'll be taking the donations this Sunday and next Sunday. I will have to deliver everything over to the school on that following Wednesday. I believe it's the 19th. But nevertheless, if you have anything that you would like to give to this family who is in need, the family has two daughters, one is 9 and one is 13. And if there's anything that I send a list out on text the list out to everybody that is on our text line. But anybody that is not and you're getting this word, you can contact me and I would be more than happy to come by and pick up whatever it is that you would like to donate to this great family that's in need. And we already have some folks that have already participated. And I thank God for you, and I'm sure the family's gonna enjoy it as well. So that's, I just want to put that out there. I'll give you some more information on that at a later time. All right, God bless you. We ready for
Amen. 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 inside the tomb. This is a representation of that. We also have the canvas that we're looking at. And it's letting us know, it's reminding each and every one of us that Jesus is still the light of the world. Even in this day, he is still the light of the world. Amen. And we have a cross that we always take off the communion table, and we also realize that Jesus is no longer on the cross. He's still a risen Savior. We celebrate Christmas and the birth of Jesus Christ because that's what we do. But we do know that he was resurrected on the third day. He's no longer on the cross. So we don't want to carry around this all year long knowing that Jesus still hanging on the cross. He's no longer there. So we remove the cross from our table. Then we have our implements that we're going to pray over. And I'm going to ask Deacon Winston to pray over the bread and Minister Johanna to pray over the wine at this time. Amen.
Night in which he was betrayed, took bread.
And when he had given thanks, he broke
This do ye as oft as ye drink it in remembrance of me.
For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come.
Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord.
But if a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup.
For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body.
For this house many are weak and sickly among you, and be asleep.
For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged.
But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world.
Wherefore, my brethren, when ye come together to eat, tarry one for another.
And if any man hunger, let him eat at home, and ye come not together in confrontation, and the rest I will set in order.
When I come. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You only have your seats. Praise be. On the night that he was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it. And he reminded the disciples that this is my body. This represents my flesh. Eat ye all of it in remembrance of me. And then he took the cup and he sucked it. Blessed it. And you let them know that this is the blood of my body. As you drink this blood, remember this is the power that's going to run through your veins. The power that's going to sustain you in these days that are going to come. Trying times that's going to come upon you. This blood is going to be the power to you. Drink you all. We're going to do the same. We're going to sing a song that we sing here in Morning Star as we dismiss. not, it'll be part of our benediction, so as soon as we finish with the song, we'll